Last of the key poems of the pre-1914 then. It's another Browning poem, The Laboratory. And obviously, before, as you know, this is going to be a little twisted, like My Last Duchess. And if you are interested in his kind of style of poetry, there's another good one called Porphyria's Lover, which you can Google. So we'll read through this one. And I'll probably skip quite a bit because there's quite a lot of detail in the same thing. But obviously, I'll just go over the whole stanza and then we'll go into the smart points. So basically, you've got a woman in a chemist's, an old-style chemist's. Now that I'm sitting here watching you work, and I'm watching the smoke come up from the concoctions that you're making as you do what you do in this little devil's paradise where things are made, can you please tell me which poison are you going to use to poison her? You know, my husband, he's actually with her, and they know that I know where they are and what they are doing, having an affair, and they think that I am crying over them while they can sit and laugh at me, and they think that I've run off to the church to pray to God and ask for help. But no, I am here. Chemist, I command you, keep working away, mash and moisten the paste that you are actually making, and grind down the powder. I can wait as long as it takes for you to make the best poison possible. I would rather sit here than go and watch the strange things that my husband and his lover are doing. But I will be going there later because they've all gone to have a dance at the king's reception. Chemist, what is that in what you are making? You call that the gum? I wonder which tree such gold droppings, oozings come from. And in that soft blue test tube, what is it? I bet it looks like it tastes so sweet. Is that poison also? I would take all the things that you actually have, and that would be a brilliant set of things to actually own, because then I'd be carrying death around with me, and I could put it in any kind of vessel that I wanted and kill. Because soon I'll be at the king's, and I'll give a small sweet-like thing to Pauline, and she will only have 13 minutes to live. And then to another, I will give a small pastel like a locket. And Elise, with her head and her breasts and her arms and her hands, will all shrivel and she'll drop dead. Come on, quickly now, I want to get this done. Have you finished yet? Wait, no, that colour's too dark. Why can't you make it nice and enticing and look pretty like the test tube that I pointed out earlier? Because I want it to look bright in her drink. So then she is interested in it and she stirs it, and then she wants to try it and taste, and obviously it will do what it has to do to her. So this is it. Don't put just a tiny small amount, because she's not small, not pathetic like me. That's how she managed to actually capture my husband. She isn't the kind of person that will take no for an answer. And I heard last night that they whispered, and I actually brought my eyes to look at her so that I could actually stare for 1.5 minute and try and kill her with my daggers, with try and kill her with my evil looks. But it didn't happen at all. I want her, I'm telling you, to feel loads of pain. I want her to die, and I want there to be some painful remnants of the fact that she's died on her face. I want it to brand her so she's got incisions in her. I want it to burn up, and I want it to bite into her beauty, because I want her to look completely ugly so he completely remembers her dying face. Finally, is it done? Then take off my mask and I'll actually show you who I am. No, don't be sad that you've actually made this thing that's going to kill her. This delicate droplet that you've put together that's cost me every single penny. Hold on, I wonder, if this is going to do such damage to her, I wonder if carrying it around could it hurt me? Now, who cares about that? I tell you what, take all my jewels that you wanted as payment. Gorge gold, fill yourself with all my gold as much as you want. And also, this has kind of turned me on a little, so I tell you, you may kiss me, old man, if you want to. But then get all this dust and powder off me, because I don't want anyone to suspect anything. Because now I have to go and look completely inconspicuous, because I'm off to go to that dance at the king's. So basically, a woman plotting revenge. She's in a chemist, an old-style chemist, and she's actually gathering poison so she can go and kill her husband's lover. Okay, so with the structure, well, we've got the 12 parts. Obviously, 12 parts can represent 12 hours. Not necessarily that she was waiting there for 12 hours, but it's just an idea that she's waiting in stages. So it obviously represents time, and it represents how much she's waiting. It also represents how carefully thought out it is. She knows it takes its time. Even the part where she says quickly, and is it done, those kind of questioning, it's basically she's still waiting. I mean, the stanzas are all quite evenly length. They're not exactly the same, but they're evenly length. Both of the, they're all just kind of building towards actually the instruction of this woman. You've got a dash all the way through that's used as kind of like to obviously a very conversational tone, and obviously to show the pacing as it actually kind of breaks in and breaks out again. And then at times and at places, you've got the enjambment again to actually make us just hang and concentrate on certain words. Also with the structuring of the 12 parts there, they flow, but they don't flow kind of logically. I mean, you could mix them up, it wouldn't really make a difference. So it's just kind of like fractious thought that she's having. Maybe she just comes out of her rage just long enough to actually explain this to the chemist before moving on. So the meanings behind this, well, obviously revenge. She wants to get back at this person. I mean, first reason she wants to get back at him is because obviously they're laughing at her, and second of all, also because she's not a minion like her, so she actually makes her feel very weak. The jealousy is obviously very evident from that part as well, and also the fact that she wants her not to just die, but she wants to be absolutely, I mean, the revenge she wants to get there because of her jealousy, she wants her to just be burnt into pieces, you know, really feel the pain, and she wants him to actually remember it, and then maybe she becomes prettier by default if the other person that he left her for is completely disfigured in some way. Obviously, one of the other things that she touches upon is obviously murder and the presupposed murder, which is obviously mentioned quite several times all through this stanza here, actually. And also, there's two names mentioned here, so we wonder if there are actually two people that she wants to kill. And also, there's the caring about others' thoughts, obviously, because she is interested in what they think of her with regards to them being at church, and also interested in how he's going to look at her when it's actually coming across. And also, the idea of she's worried, she stops for a second to think about what the chemist is actually thinking, knowing the fact that he's actually produced something for death. So there's a lot of kind of looking around into other people's thoughts in this. So the images we get great images of the poison up near the beginning, with obviously this poison actually being made, and obviously the gum that's actually in it offering gold oozings. So it's almost like riches. The images is like kind of that's the value there, obviously, which she compares to the gold that she gives over for it at the end, which would be a good comparison to make a cross reference to. Obviously, there's kind of like a hellish atmosphere at the beginning here because she calls it the devil's smithy, and a smithy is basically the blacksmith's. So basically, it's a place where things get made, and so this is where the place where the devil's things get made, because obviously it's something being made to kill with. And here we obviously have the idea of smoke as well, which adds to it being hellish. You've got this idea of something being very small but very deadly, which is obviously quite lethal. We've got it in a lozenge and a pastille, so basically they're the size of, you know, the hall sweets you get if you've got a sore throat, and the lockets, etc. They're about that size. And then you've got the language use, you've got alliteration in Fortune's Fee that just has a real sinisterism about it. It's just down the bottom here. There we go. The whole Fortune's Fee. It's supposed to sound like quite a lot, but it doesn't. It just sounds like she will give everything for it. I mean, because that's like a secondary thing to her now. Her revenge is number one. Also, the uses of the dashes, again, to dictate the tone. Obviously, show that it's conversational. And you've got the metaphor when she actually says she's no minion like me. So she doesn't actually refer to herself as like an underling, etc. And also the language, just with the colours that you actually get through here. Obviously, we want things to be enticing, dim, to brighten it. We've got the gold, obviously, and the exquisite blue, all these kind of colors just kind of coming to life, all these shades, and that gives us nice, because it helps us build a nice image, because we're sitting there in the watching all this unfold in a chemist's, and so you can imagine it's like a little laboratory where they've got all the different obviously a laboratory where they've got all the different chemicals in different vials and different test tubes, etc., before they're all being put together. So, emotions, sorry, the effect on us. Well, what do we make? Obviously, it gets us thinking about what emotions, you know, do we feel when we get into certain situations? How do we handle situations? Do we look for revenge, or do we kind of slink away from things? Or do we challenge things, or do we just think it's being the bigger man to walk away, etc., etc., if you excuse the cliche? Also, maybe gets us thinking about what would make us kill. I mean, what kind of situation would we have to be in before we actually thought about doing something like that? And also, who is it that should dish out punishment and revenge? I mean, obviously here, maybe even now, I mean, jilted lovers, if someone cheats on someone and leaves someone, there's no actual recourse apart from a couple of people will say maybe a couple of bad things about that person, but there's no real recourse or riposte in terms of a punishment. So should there be one? You know, maybe these are the kind of things that actually be sparked off and hopefully get you thinking. And now we're done with 1914.